Good morning and welcome to worship with Carmichael Presbyterian Church this morning, July 25, 2021. And this is our 10 a.m. live stream worship service. And it's good of you to be with us, and we're grateful for this time together. My name is Ivan Herman, associate pastor here, along with my colleague, Pastor Keith DeVries. And it's a joy to lead in this morning of worship together. And we invite you to let us know who you are. Sign in on the registration link. Let us know that you are here with us today. Also, let us know whatever prayer requests you may have. That registration link can be found on the church website. It can be found in the bulletin or the e-parish notes. Stick around for a few moments following the benediction today, and you will see a special art show, a photography by Claire Doherty, called Seattle, So Many Places, So Little Time. As we do continue live streaming worship services at 10 a.m., we also have an 8:45 a.m. in-person worship service in McMillan Hall. But we are also looking forward to being back here in the sanctuary together at some point, we hope, in the near future. To give you an update on how that is going, we are bouncing back and forth plans with the county on how to repair the air conditioning unit and some of the construction that goes along with that. So that we can have good circulation here in the sanctuary and provide a comfortable and safe place for all of us. But we've been raising some funds for this, and I'd like to thank you this morning for your generosity to help provide for this construction and repair. We have received 137 contributions for a total of about $97,000 to help with this. And so you have done a wonderful job, and we are grateful. And we look forward to putting that money to good use and preparing this space for our in-person worship very, very soon. I remind you that we continue to have office hours. The church office is open Monday through Wednesday, 9 to 4, and we'll be glad to respond to email at other times as well. But those are the times you can find somebody in the office to answer questions or provide information about the community of faith and how we serve one another. Well, now I invite you to turn in your bulletins as we are prepared for this time of worship and called into it. So hear now these words of invitation. Come, you who hunger for food, worship the Lord who turns wants into plenty. Come, you who hunger for justice, worship the Lord who turns weeping into laughter. Come, you who hunger for life, worship the Lord, who is our hope and our strength. We worship our God by lifting our praises and recognizing God's love. And I invite you to sing together, Jesus Loves Me.
Randy and Ivan for helping me with that this morning, but I thought we'd hear it again maybe with a little more energy and joyfulness as I've invited Brittany, Emmy, Harper, and Zora to now lead us in singing Jesus Loves Me.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so.
thanks to the ladies of the Leslie family as they have led us in that time, reminding us of God's intense love for us that is always and forever. And we give thanks. And because of that, we are set free to also speak words of truth about where we find ourselves in our lives. And so I invite you to join in this time of confession as we speak truth. Unbelievers are not the only foolish people who act as if there is no God. Even in the midst of the miracles of life, we often do not acknowledge God's presence. And yet the Spirit is with us as the source of life. Therefore, let us confess our sins and receive Christ's mercy. Let us pray together our unison prayer of confession. God of wonder, Lord of King David and of the Son, the Messiah, David's greater Son, we confess our sins and pray for your help so that we can truly repent and turn from evil. Deliver us from the temptation to hide from you, to lie to you, or to excuse ourselves because of the harm we have done to others. Forgive us the curse we have brought upon the earth. Restore your creation to full health and feed the multitudes from the abundance of your merciful power. Grow in us a deeper desire to love Christ with the fullness of your love and to glorify him along with you and the Holy Spirit now and forever. Amen. Take a few moments now in silence to pray. People of God, hear these words of assurance. The river of God's mercy runs deeper and wider than our sin. God removes our sins as far as the heavens are above the earth. Beloved in the risen Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. We respond to that good news of forgiveness by singing together our praises to our triune God with the words of the Gloria Patri.
Well, good morning to my young friends and their families. Good to see you all here on the front steps of the sanctuary. I wanted to know how everybody's doing so far this summer. I hope you've been doing well. Hey, I thought I'd ask you a question. What are some of the plants and things that are in your yard that you maybe have to take care of or water or prune? What are some of those things? Anybody have roses? One of my favorites, right? Roses. What about... let's see, trees, got a few trees in your yard, weeds, who's got weeds? Oh, we all got weeds, oh man, oh yeah, we got all kinds of stuff. We have something that grows in our backyard that is always in need of attention and pruning and cutting, and that is this. Anybody know what this is? This is the top of a bamboo shoot, and in our backyard, we have a wall of bamboo that is about, I'd say 20 feet maybe. Yeah, about 20 feet high. And it was planted in our backyard before we even moved into the house 20 years ago. And now that bamboo goes to the neighbor's house on one side, the neighbor's house on another side, neighbor's house behind us, the neighbor's house behind us, the neighbor's house behind us. And now about five other houses have bamboo in their yard thanks to the previous owners of the house we live in. So, you know, it's always in need of pruning and taking care of, but I thought I'd bring you something, too, that's kind of interesting. This is its root system. Now, take a look. Have you seen a bamboo root? This is, maybe we can get a little closer on that. I don't know. So look at that. It's got, here's the root ball right here underneath the stalk, right? But then look at how this kind of goes out like tentacles. Look at, isn't that weird? Yeah, and it just, it spreads everywhere, and it's invasive, and it's hard to control, and it's just, oh, it's kind of a mess, right? You see that? But it's what it's doing with it, searching out for nutrients and water, and it just kind of grows and grows and grows. So the reason I wanted to show you that root ball of the bamboo plant is because I'm going to be reading from Ephesians in a few minutes, and it talks about how we are to be rooted and grounded in love. Yeah, so kind of like this root ball, God's love spreads out. It's got tentacles. It goes everywhere. It wants everyone to know how much they are loved and how we are to be a part of that love. So whenever you're working out in the yard, you're thinking about all those plants you're taking care of and you're pruning, I want you to think about their root systems and how those roots spread out and grow in order to keep the plant alive, and how God's love is kind of like that, how it spreads out and grows in order that we can share the good news of God's love with so many people in the world in which we live. So great to see you today. Thanks for looking at my root ball for my bamboo plant. Hope that you have a great week. We'll see you right here on these steps next Sunday. Take care.
Please sing with us. Please sing with us.
Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from Ephesians chapter 3, beginning with verse 14. As you listen to these words, listen to it as it is coming to you meant to be a prayer. Hear now God's word to us. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that, according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him, by the power at work within us, is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. May God bless to us the reading of God's holy word. So I need to confess that when it comes to yard work and maintaining the yard and pruning and all of those things, I've got a problem. I have a root problem. I have a problem about roots formerly attached to liquid amber trees. How many of you out there have those liquid amber trees in your yard, or maybe used to have them in your yard? When we moved into our home some 20 years ago, we thought we were so blessed with these two beautiful liquid amber trees that provide lots and lots of shade and are characterized by spectacular fall foliage as the leaves will turn bright red and yellow every single year. We quickly discovered, though, that these beautiful shade trees can also be somewhat problematic as they produce a plethora of prickly seed pods. And those seed pods just kind of drop everywhere and they get under your feet and your shoes, they end up in the rain gutters, and they just can be such a problem. We also discovered that these trees have a very, very robust and invasive root system that migrates to every corner of our house, under our house, and everywhere throughout the yard. We quickly realized that what we thought were these beautiful trees were going to be a big problem. For the last 18 years, we had this love-hate relationship with these trees until finally, at the urging of our neighbors and an arborist, we made the decision to remove those trees 2 years ago. But guess what? We still have a liquid amber root problem. As I continue to find liquid amber shoots sprouting up in my yard, in my roses, in my shrubs, and just about everywhere. So when the author of Ephesians uses the mixed metaphor of being rooted and grounded, I tend to have conflicted feelings. To be rooted and grounded suggests images of planting and building, those ways in which you can be nourished throughout your life, and those ways upon which you can build your life. But during this pandemic season, many people's lives have been rooted and grounded in fear and anxiety as we continue to deal with the latest variant and who is and who isn't vaccinated. During the latest election cycle, our lives were rooted and grounded in our political leanings. And for many of us, as we retreated indoors during the pandemic, we found ourselves rooted and grounded in the latest streaming service or your favorite TV show. FYI, for Keith, Jenny, and Dad, Dean, Jenny's dad, we have been thoroughly rooted and grounded in the Netflix TV show Heartland. Check it out, it's all about horses, kind of fun. But here in this letter to the Ephesians, the author, traditionally attributed to Paul, but more likely to have been written by Paul's students and or followers who were trying to preserve Paul's teachings with authority, offer a prayer for the Christian life that would strengthen their hearts and open their lives to new possibilities. You might say the entire Ephesians letter is a prayer book, as the author encourages his readers to be rooted and grounded in prayer. Our text begins with this attitude of prayer and worship, acknowledging God as Father, as Mother, as Parent, as the God and Parent of all families and tribes, inclusive of all humanity, peoples, and nations. The language of family is at the core of this text as we rediscover the art of prayer and how we can grow in relationship with God through prayer. This prayer can then be divided into four parts or four partitions for the recipients of the letter in Ephesus. The first petition is that they be strengthened in their inner being from the inside out by the power of God's Holy Spirit. The second petition is that Christ may dwell in their hearts, heart being the seat of their being, their intelligence and thought, rather than how we often understand it as the place of emotion or feeling. This petition seeks to have Christ control their whole being in every way. The third petition is for knowledge and comprehension, so that along with all the saints, a word often used to denote the baptized ones or Christians, they might comprehend the extent of God's work in the world and what is the breadth, length, and height and depth of God's sovereignty. And finally, the fourth petition is that they would know the love of Christ that surpasses all knowledge and that they might be filled with God's fullness. The author of this letter then prays that Jesus Christ might dwell within them so that they might understand the scope of God's ministry in Jesus Christ that is for both Jew and Gentile, and then embrace a life of prayer that is rooted and grounded in love. Now, I believe, I absolutely know, that you give expression to this love in your very active prayer lives as God's people here at CPC. Whenever there are prayers needed, you respond, and I know this because my iPhone blows up with notifications that you are all praying. I know this because I often hear a prayer request from second and third parties before the families have even had a chance to contact me directly. I know this because of your response to the weekly e-prayer list and the prayer list in our parish notes. I know this because of our prayer shawl ministry that touches so many lives. And I know this because of how you contribute to the prayers of intercession and worship on Sunday morning, either in person or by sharing your prayer requests online. As God's people, you are truly rooted and grounded in prayer. Consequently, as you grow in the art of prayer, you have shown that the Christian life, your life, is rooted and grounded in love. I have come to believe that being rooted and grounded in love is an important metaphor for the church and for how Christians are to live their lives. Commentator Andrew T. Lincoln says that this text communicates to the Ephesian Christians that, quote, love is the soil in which believers are to be rooted and grow, the foundation on which they are to be built. And then he goes on to say, love is the fundamental principle of the new age of Christian existence in general, and not just of Christian character. As in Paul's hymn to love in 1 Corinthians 13, love is to be seen as God's love embodied in Christ and mediated by the Spirit, but also as the power that moves believers to love others with no expectation of receiving anything in return. Having acknowledged how important that metaphor is for the church, I also recognize that we are all weary of this endless pandemic with a possibility of new restrictions looming in front of us and the Delta variant becoming widespread. And yes, we are all sick and tired of wearing masks and social distancing. I know that the challenges of COVID-19 have in many situations robbed us of our patience and goodwill, that anxiety and fear have replaced our experiences of Christ's boundless love, and that we are often no longer able to imagine the breadth and scope of God's loving acts in our world. But that is precisely why we must continue to be attentive to one another and the needs of our community and our world. That is why we must continue to nourish our faith and our prayer life. That is why we must be reminded every day that God is at work in our midst, even when we can't imagine it, and even when we fail to live faithfully, graciously, lovingly, and courageously. It is fitting that the act of worship and prayer, which defines our text today, would end with a doxology, a short statement of praise, as the author of this letter expresses his ongoing confidence and gratitude to God, who can and who will do more than we could ever ask or imagine, and whose generosity is not limited by our ability or our lack of understanding. Glory be to God, and may it be true today and always as we seek to be rooted and grounded in the love of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we thank you for the invitation to be rooted and grounded. We thank you for your love that is so pervasive, invasive, spreading, and calling more of us to also join together with you in that love. So bless us, O Lord, in that rooting and in that grounding as we seek to be your faithful disciples, sharing that good news of your love. In whose name we pray, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Please sing with us.
Thank you.
The psalmist said that God opens God's hand, satisfying the desire of every living thing. So may God also open our hands and our hearts, as in gratitude we return our tithes and our offerings to the one who satisfies, to the one who saves. Let us pray together. God of all provision, receive and gather these offerings and bless them, so that all may be satisfied, all the hungry may be fed, and that you, O God, may be able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine. To you be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. As we come to a time of prayer, as we lift up our joys and concerns, we also know that in these times we gather, that we celebrate moments of life together, and we also grieve together when loved ones die. And we learned this week of the death of Nadine Hills. And so I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we honor and remember Nadine. We give thanks for Nadine, for the gifts of God that were in her, and for the gift that she was to us. She's now been embraced by her Creator in death, just as she was embraced by her Creator in life. And we hold those who love her also in prayer, her family, her friends, and her community. We pray for her husband, Ed, as he grieves and as he also faces his own health concerns. So we give thanks to God for the gift of God's servant, Nadine, for all in her that was good and kind and faithful. This is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Thank you for taking this moment to remember her. You're welcome to be seated. This week, we also hold in prayer Lisa Benedom. Lisa went into hospital with a seizure earlier this week, is now recovering, making improvements each day. We lift up prayers of healing for her, also of strength and perseverance for her husband, Dave, and their daughter, Kristen. And this is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. We hold in prayer Gary Lee. Gary's been diagnosed with acute leukemia. And we pray for him and for Charlene as they make decisions about his ongoing care. This is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. We hold Mary Simpson in prayer and her husband, John. Mary had a procedure about a week and a half ago, hoping for some pain relief, and it indeed has accomplished that. So she's now facing a more permanent solution, which we are grateful for. We hold her in prayer as they're making decisions and preparing for that. And this is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. Also, continued prayers for Hazel Smith as she had spinal surgery last Thursday. We pray for her recovery and her pain relief. And this is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. We hold in prayer Joseph and Florence Kawesa in Uganda, their foster son, Joroge, as COVID-19 goes through their family again. And Joroge has been released from hospital, is recovering, but it continues to burden their family. And so we pray for them, and this is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. You'll see on page 2 of the parish notes not only the prayer list, but also the names of those who we remember today who are members or who have family in the military. And we pray for all of those who are serving in uniform, for military, for public safety, for those who are fighting fires, and for those who are helping a healing process. And this is our prayer to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. Let us pray together. Holy God, how can suffering come to an end? How can pain ease, grief ebb, hunger be satiated? How can weapons be laid down and anxiety calmed and corruption fought and division overcome? Your promises to provide and the path of hope you lay out, Holy God, seem impossible under the weight of all of our woes. and yet still we pause and pray. We turn to you, speak to you, shorten the distance between us and you, in the hope and in the faith that you listen when your people pray. You love, you weep, you act. And grateful for your ear, holy God, we lift our prayers to you. May those who are in need of healing experience the balm of your nurturing care. May those in need of courage find inspiration in the heroes and heroines of your written word. May those in need of reconciliation find empowerment in your path of peace. May those in need of guidance be blessed with your insight and wisdom. Eternal One who blesses all of life, bless and renew us all. Time moves so fast. Life is always ahead of us, urging us faster and faster, but may this moment of prayer and pause help us hear the wind paging through the trees. Help us feel the warm hug of the sun. Help us see the stars flaring. Help us smell the flowers across the street. May this moment of communion help us remember the support and the sustenance that we have in this body, with each other and with you. United as a family of faith and as the body of Christ, we lift these prayers to you, God, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Hear us pray the prayer that Christ taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, go forth out into the world this week with the assurance that you are rooted and grounded in the love of God in Jesus Christ. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the love of God and communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and evermore. Amen and amen.